Welcome to Rockline on MTV, where you get to talk to your favorite artists live. And our toll-free number is 1-800-34-ROCK. That is 344-7625. If your call gets on the air, you will receive a box of 10 Sony UX Turbo audio tapes. And they're designed to stand the heat of your car's interior, even on a hot summer day. And they are only from Sony Recording Media. My guest today, Jeff Tate, Chris DeGarmo of Queensryche.
We want to be on the cutting edge, you know. We want to be on the edge of technology, on the edge of experimentation.
That's one thing we've always tried to keep as our slogan with the band is no limits. Is there
anybody? What's cool with our fans is that they, you know, they've gone along with this like total ride that we've been taking everybody on. This album, you know, as a result, shows a lot of different possibilities of where Queensryche can go musically.
It's not really original anymore, yeah. You know, it's the same 12 notes, you know, how many times can you play it? But the key is to try and be as unique as you can.
And here they are in the studio, Chris DeGarmo, Jeff Tate of Queensryche. Hi, welcome.
Hi, Martha.
Nice to be here.
Thanks for coming all the way down from Seattle. We threw the rain in LA just so you felt more comfortable.
Thank you. That was very powerful of you to do that.
Yes, well, you know, multi-talented. So you just got off the road after, like, how long?
14 months we spent on the road this year.
Have you, like, gotten into relaxation mode, or are you still sort of, you know, ready to wake up and go pack into the bus and go do another show, or are you able to sort of relax?
Well, I think it's kind of starting to happen now. We've been a month off the road now, and we're starting to relax a bit. But every night about 8:30, I get very excited for some reason.
Yeah.
Start pacing the floor, but I'm starting to relax a little bit now.
And you have your friends and neighbors go, ladies and gentlemen, Jeff Tate, come into the living room. Well, lots going on. We have a brand new video. We just saw a piece of it. You've got some Grammy nominations. You've got the new home video. And we have a lot of questions from everybody out there. And we'll get started. We have a call from New Jersey, from Hazlett, New Jersey, I believe. It is Mike on the line. Hi, Mike. Welcome to the show. Say hello.
Hi, Jeff. Hi, Martha.
Hi, Mike.
Hi. I have a question. Why did you decide to use an orchestra band for the Video Music Awards?
Well, the track that we were performing, Silent Lucidity, has orchestra accompanying it, and we thought it would be nice to try to duplicate, you know, the sounds live by bringing out this orchestra. And I think it turned out really well. It was very fun to work with the different musicians and sort of teach them the song. We spent a couple days rehearsing. And it turned out really well, I think.
The rehearsals when everybody else was setting up, you know, what they were doing, and you guys came in with this orchestra, was everybody saying, what are you guys doing?
Yeah, I think they were happy that we gave these people something to do.
Well, it was definitely neat. It was great in the show. Thanks for the question, Mike. And we're going to go to Gallipolis, Ohio, where Terry is on the line. Hey, Terry, what's up?
Hi. I was at the latest Monsters of Rock at Castle Dyneton, England, and y'all were great.
Thank
my
you.
Question is, which do you prefer doing, the Monsters of Rock tours or your arena tours where you are the headliners?
Well, each is certainly has its positive points. I think by doing our own show, we're able to really present Queensryche in the type of situation that we dream of. We get to think up all the staging ideas, the lighting, our set list, how long we want to play. In the Monsters of Rock situation, we are part of a bigger show where we are just offering a particular amount of songs in kind of someone else's set. And it's different. I mean, they're both great opportunities to be able to do. We were very happy to be on the Monsters of Rock, but I think if we had a preference as to which way to present Queensryche, I think letting us paint the pictures a little more exciting, actually.
Boy, that must have been a good show, Terry. Thanks a lot for calling. And we've got Jennifer on the line, who is calling from Yuma, Arizona. Hi, Jennifer. Say hello to Chris and Jeff.
Hi, Jeff. Hi, Chris.
Hello. Hello.
My question is for Jeff. I know you play keyboards, but do you play any other instruments?
Not very well. In fact, I don't really play keyboards that well. The best thing I do is sing, really. And I'm just lucky that the guys let me put a few keyboard sounds here and there in the album to satisfy my need to be a musician. I started out as on piano when I was a kid, and then I went to trumpet and played in the school orchestra for a while, and French horn, I played that for a while. And then I gave it all up to a singer.
Were you in the high school chorus or things like that?
Junior high, yeah.
You were?
Mm-hmm.
And did you ever take singing professionally? I mean, take singing lessons professionally?
Briefly, when I was first learning how.
And when you're out on the road night after night, how do you keep your voice in shape? Do you have exercises that you do?
No, I really don't do anything.
A schedule of decadence, I'm sure, Jay.
Yeah, really, I do all the wrong things, probably. I just try to keep care of myself. Physically, I think that helps, and get enough sleep. And I don't, knock on some sort of wood. There's no wood in here.
Yeah,
no. I haven't had a problem, keeping up with it, except when I get sick, which is rarely. But when I do get sick, it's very difficult to sing.
Yeah.
Because your body is your instrument, and if it's injured or hurting, then it's difficult to put out that kind of energy it takes.
Have you ever had to cancel a show?
Once. Back in 85, we canceled Edmonton, Alberta.
Because if the rest of the guys are sick, I mean, you could play guitar with a runny nose and, feeling bad. But if it's you, if it's the singer, that's a whole different thing.
Yeah, if it's Scott, our drummer, or me, then it gets kind of touchy and the whole band suffers, because of the energy level. But, luckily we had a good tour this year where everybody stayed pretty healthy.
Good. Well, good. Thanks, Jennifer. That was a good call. And we've got Gary on the line. Gary is calling us from Tulsa, Oklahoma today. Hey, Gary, how are you?
Doing good.
Good. What's your question?
I was wanting to know where you got the idea for the video Silent Lucidity and who produced it.
Well, a gentleman by the name of Matt Mahurin directed that clip, and we just started that process by, talking with Matt about what the song was about and letting him give us his interpretation of what he thought the song was about. And hopefully we come to some sort of agreement there. Generally that's how we work with someone on the video. As long as their idea is a fairly accurate representation of what it was we were trying to, get across there. And Matt's was a real nice, presentation. He wanted it to be very dreamy and very warm, something that was a very comfortable feeling visual image, and we thought that sounded great on paper.
Which is exactly how he presented it. He had a few sheets of paper, and he'd drawn out these little boxes and filled them in with these.
So you're essentially looking at like a cartoon.
Yeah, yeah. Very tiny little drawings that you needed a magnifying glass to really decipher.
And figures.
He had about two pages of stuff, and then a lot of empty boxes that were really left to be filled in.
And then what was your reaction when you saw the video? You must have been pleased.
Yeah, it looked really good. I think it fit the song.
It was more, a lot of times I think we can extract more out of a conversation, than we can looking. Oftentimes someone will draw a real elaborate picture for us, but when that translates to the actual process of making the video, that can be something completely different. So if we're connecting, mentally on something, then we generally will roll with that more than a pretty picture.
And sometimes, depending on the scenario, but a lot of times you just make it up on the spot.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you have a basic outline, and then you kind of just fill in the blanks the day of the shoot.
Oh, boy. Okay, well,
it's kind of like doing a live show. Like
expensive ad-libbing.
So, okay, we are going to come back. We have Chris and Jeff, Queensryche, of course. You can call us up. Call us right this very second. Our toll-free number is 1-800-344-ROCK, and that's 7625. Our guests are Jeff Tate, Chris DeGarmo of Queensryche. Call us now. We'll put you on hold and get you on after the break. Next to you, silent lucidity. Welcome back. It's Rockline on MTV. And my guests today are Jeff Tate and Chris DeGarmo of Queensryche. You can call us up if you have a question. The number is, and it's toll-free, 1-800-44-ROCK. You were just saying that you flew in from Amsterdam to do that?
Yeah, we flew in from Amsterdam to do the MTV Music Award. Flew out that same night to go back to Germany for a show. And we were in a real serious state of jet lag. And we got on the plane after the show. They helicoptered us from the site down to LAX. We jumped on the plane, just barely made it, and shot off to Germany. And we slept the whole way because we were exhausted.
Uh-huh.
We got to Germany. It was probably about 8, 9 at night. So we were wide awake. So everybody in the entourage, we all went down to the bar to consume quantities of
to take care of your voice a little more.
Yeah. And they had a TV down there, and somebody flipped on the television, and there was the Music Awards, and there we were playing Silent City on TV. It was sort of a very weird situation.
That is funny.
Twilight Zone kind of.
That's funny. Well, you're watching Rockline on MTV, and we got the guys here. You could call us up, and we have a call from Harlingen, Texas. Ileana is on the line. Hi, Ileana. What's your question?
Oh, I'd like to say I saw your show in San Antonio, and it looked and sounded magnificent.
Thank you.
And my question is how you regard your past work and albums, mainly your Rage for Order days.
How we regard them?
Yeah.
Oh, I think we really like a lot of the stuff we've done in the past. Some of it's sort of dated now when you look back on it, but...
Yeah, because we were just talking about how music standing the test of time.
Yeah.
What do you think about your own music?
Well, some of it does. That particular period, Rage for Order, is a very experimental time for the band. We were really trying to push ourselves musically into different directions and experiment. And, some of the songs really hold up. And we're really, I think, very proud of, the work we did on that album. And, even though it didn't, set the world on fire as far as sales go, we felt artistically very pleased that, we had done something that, we felt proud of musically.
Mm-hmm.
And I think at the end of the day, that's where what it comes down to is
time capsules, really.
Yeah.
Each particular recording is just kind of a snapshot of where we were at that particular time, what we were thinking about, and always, life moves forward. Sometimes you look back at a particular snapshot and you go, oh God, I hate that one, or I love that one, and I don't know, I think we have to just, stand by all of them as that's where we were, that's what we were thinking about, and glad that somebody remembers it enough to call us and ask us about it.
And that's Ileana. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ileana.
And now we have a call from, Livonia, Michigan. And Zane is on the line. Hi, Zane.
Hi, how you doing?
What's your question?
Hi, I wanted to say your show at Joe Louis Arena last year was, amazing.
Thank you.
It was great. And I was wondering, on the Operation Mindcrime album, are any of the characters, like Dr. X or Nikki or anything, are any of them based on, real people heard of or know or anything like that?
Yeah, they are. They're all based on somebody. Dr. X was based upon a character that I met in Montreal, Quebec, at this sort of bizarre nightclub where these people met to talk politics all the time. It was there's a separatist movement in Quebec to separate themselves from the Union of Canada, and these people were radical revolutionaries who were out to destroy all English-speaking people and businesses and return the province to a totally French government and all this, which apparently is taking place now. And the character of Mary we met in a club in Amsterdam in '86. Who was a woman dressed like a nun, and she was dancing to this very up-tempo disco music, but she was sort of moving in slow motion. I think she was on heroin, and she was clutching this ragged teddy bear to her chest, and she had the most sad look on her face, like she'd really lived a rough life. And just the vision of it, through the lights and the smoke and, the atmosphere really struck a note with us. And she was sort of a visual inspiration for the character of Mary on the album.
Did you write all the lyrics on that?
Except for The Mission, which Chris wrote.
So predominantly you wrote all the lyrics.
Yeah.
And now there's a lot more co-writing. Chris wrote Silent Lucidity.
Mm-hmm.
What was the change?
Well, we've always sort of split, the lyric writing chores up. That particular album, I was just on a roll.
Uh-huh.
And Chris was very into what I was doing lyrically, and we sort of bounced ideas off each other, and he came up with a song, The Mission, which really fit well into what I was working on. And he just kind of let me do my thing, which I really appreciate because it was working, and we went from there.
Are you guys both married?
Mm-hmm.
And do you have children?
No.
You don't? Are you going to someday? Because you gave me that little, like, that little Seattle shirt.
Could be, possibly, working on it.
Because
you know?
I was going to say, if you said you did, I was thinking, well, when do you ever see, would you ever see your kids? When do you see your wives? You're out on the road so much. Just about now.
Well, we collect all kinds of frequent flyer miles, you see, Martha. And we've helped support the airline industry, even in a recession year, with our family's plane tickets all around the globe. Well, they come out with us. You know, things are going nice now, so we can include
your families. Yeah, that's good.
Which it used to be the first couple of years. It was kind of tough. We'd disappear for a while, and, you know, that was just the way it is. But now...
It's like sending your rock boys off to the rock and roll war out in the field.
That's right.
This is Rockline on MTV. Today's guests, Jeff Tate and Chris DeGarmo of Queensryche. We will be back. It's Rockline on MTV. If you have a question for Chris or Jeff, you can still call us. The toll-free number is 1-800-344-ROCK, and that's 344-7625. And I should mention, if your call gets on the air, you'll box 10 Sony UX Turbo audio tapes designed to stand the heat of your car's interior, even on a hot summer day, and that's only from Sony Recording Media. And I feel like I'm rushing because this is our last segment with you, and I want to know about the Grammys. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
What are you nominated for?
God.
I'll tell you if you don't know. I believe it's Best Rock Performance by Group or Duo. And
with a vocal.
With a vocal. See, you do know. And
Best Song.
Song, so, Silent Lucidity maybe is your baby, Chris, yes?
Sure.
And how do you feel about it being nominated for a Grammy? How does that feel?
Well, I think it's great. It's really just sort of the icing on an already amazing year, and the whole project with Empire, the tour is really something that was kind of a little unexpected here at the end as we finished and went home and thought we were, you know, the project is done. Here surfaces, you know, a few more accolades.
The album has been out for like 2 years. You already have another video. It's like a long, like you were saying, it's just continuing. Now, Chris, I have to ask you, everybody's heard Silent Lucidity about 3,000 million times. Mm-hmm. And what exactly does the term silent lucidity mean?
Well, the song's about dream control. The title is sort of a complicated way, I guess, of saying silent awareness, which is just kind of a description of dreaming, really. And, you know, the song was, the concept of it was just kind of inspired by my own personal adventures at rest. But it was put into a story form of a child that doesn't understand the subconscious yet and is sort of has it explained to them by a person familiar with dreams and dream control. So that's really kind of the premise of Silent Lucidity. And from there, it's just sort of
clears it up.
Sort of like the name of the band, Queensryche. Lucidity is one of those words that people have a real tough time understanding and pronouncing. We were backstage and meeting some people after a show one day, and a guy comes up to me and goes, "You know, I've been following you guys for years, and I love all your stuff. I've watched all your videos, and but you know, this new song, Silence in Tennessee, it's my favorite."
Yeah, that's a good song, Silence in Tennessee.
I said, "I heard that."
Well, we have Rick on the line, who's calling from Danbury, Connecticut. Hey, Rick, how are you?
That's the wrong accent for that.
Oh, good. I just wanted to say, first off, I saw you guys live, and you guys were incredible.
Thanks, Rick.
And I also wanted to ask you, now that your Building Empires tour is done, what do you have planned next as, like, an album or a video, possibly?
Something else to build. What do we build next?
Well, we have a new video, actually, Rick. Today, you'll probably see it if you stay tuned to MTV. It's a tune called Anybody Listening, which was the last track on the Empire album. That we just filmed in Spokane and up in the Northwest where we live, the last show that we did. As far as, you know, plans for a new album, we're sort of on hiatus right now, taking the occasional trip, like to visit Martha and the Grammys maybe, but we're sort of resting and dreaming up the next album, and you know, we'll probably get started recording next fall.
See, there's that lucidity popping up.
Jeez.
Do you know who you're up against in the Grammys?
Oh yeah, some heavy hitters. Tom Petty and Bonnie Raitt.
Oh boy.
And
yeah, some veterans of the
Jane's Addiction's up for the same.
Yeah. And Metallica, standards. I believe, is up in the song category, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have some nice company.
Yeah.
Well, that'd be exciting. That'll definitely, I mean, in the old story, even if you don't win, to be nominated.
Yeah, we try not to get too jazzed up about that sort of thing, you know. The fall is a long way if you get too wound up.
All right, we have Amy who's calling. Now I can do it, from Tulsa, Oklahoma.
There you go.
Hi, Amy.
Hi.
What's your question?
How did you come up with your name and symbol?
Well, Jeff comes from...
My mother was responsible for that, actually.
Well, the name of the band is something that's kind of one of those... We don't have an elaborate story for it. I kind of wish now that we've been asked so many times about it that we do, but it was a last-minute thing. We had a couple songs together. We'd done a sort of a demo recording project, and we didn't have anything to call the band. I had this song that I had written for our first little project called Queen of the Reich, and for lack of anything better, just sort of put the words together, and there was Queensryche, and now we've been traveling around trying to get people to spell it right and say it right. And as far as the symbol goes, it's a lot simpler to look at than the 11 letters that comprise Queensryche. Maybe that's why we did it. I don't know. There's really not a great thought to it. It was just something to call the band, but sort of turned it into something, I guess, now.
And it's lasted. Thank you, Amy. And we're going to just move along to Illinois, specifically Buffalo Grove, Illinois, where Mike is waiting on the line. Mike, you're on.
Hi, guys. How's it going?
Good.
I just had a question here. First of all, I just want to tell you I'm a big Queensryche fan. And I'm just wondering, how did you get Suicidal Tendencies to open up for you? And how did that work out?
Do you like Suicidal Tendencies?
I love Suicidal Tendencies. They're great.
Why did you ask? Did you get a lot of adverse reaction?
Some people really like them, you know, on the tour, and other people didn't quite know how to take them. But I think our audience is the kind of people that approach music with an open mind, and most of them, you know, really enjoyed the variance of the two bands. We've always had this philosophy that we wanted to have, when we got a chance to headline our own shows, that we would try to pick opening bands that were very different and maybe on the cutting edge of a certain style or something like that, and Suicidal definitely is in that realm. And we just thought it'd be kind of a fun combination, which it turned out to be. They went over real well, and we got along real well with the guys in the band. We had a good time.
Cool. Well, this is it.
Done?
Time flies.
Wrapped it up. That was it. Thank you so much for coming down all the way to Los Angeles to visit us. You know, I meant to tell you this morning in New York, there was lines of people outside. They thought you were going to be in New York. Very disappointed to learn that you were here. That is it for this edition of Rockline on MTV. We'll see you next time.
Bye.
Yeah, they went out.